making a game in Corona SDK. Just gotta check the audio, as always. Make sure everything's working. We'll pick back up where we left off. As always, you can go to TylerMakes.com to check out my YouTube. You can actually watch the stream there if I'm currently streaming. And you can get to Twitter, Twitch, etc. Follow me on Twitter to find out when I'm streaming. I usually post there, which I will do momentarily. But also you can go see every one of the videos. And on the videos, you can get a link to GitHub, where all of this code exists. So you can just go grab it. One second. Okay, I need to post, of course. Started momentarily. Okay, cool. All right, so anyway, where we left off was that we were working on saving and loading levels and then making them playable. So here we are, I'm on a level, I can go play it, it's the same level. I have a different menu system, but I can't do anything with it right now. But then we can go back to the build, we can edit it, we can go load a different one, and we can go play it. So now we're gonna actually make the playing of the app work. So that's the focus for today. So I want to get right into doing that. And here's a convenient note to myself where we left off. Okay, so. Oh, yes. Okay, so what we were doing is we were going to go through the entire map, find out where the player location is, and replace that player. So here we go. Like, let's say we have all these trees. We throw down a player right here. When I go to play, what we want to do is get rid of that item from the background and make it the actual player in a player object that we're then going to manipulate. So we're going to start off with that. And what we want to do is iterate through everything. Just find the player location. What we were doing is we were iterating through all the columns. We have these layers. Remember, layers are going to be like the background. I'm wondering if I'm on. Here we go, on camera. The background, and then on top of that, you know, it might be like items and stuff that you can manipulate, and then maybe foreground elements to give it like a depth of field kind of thing. So right now we just have the one layer, which represents our background, represents everything. And for right now, well, the player is not actually going to be a part of that. The player is going to be on top of it. So it's going to be the background. Right now it's going to be the background, player, and then like everything else, the other layers. But we're not going to worry about that until we actually have other layers. I just put that in there as prep. So anyway, we're going to iterate through the columns and the rows. Going to go through each one, see the tile info. Let's try this and just see what it looks like if we did that. Throw down some trees. There, as you can see, we already did it where if you put a new player, it gets rid of the old one because we can only have one player starting location. Play. All right. What's breaking? Oh. I just changed this method name, so of course it's going to break. Building the forest. Wait, where the line is at? That is line 41 of Bulb Forest. Right here. Go ahead and save that. Oh, save that. Do we have a player set location? Yes, but it doesn't do anything. Okay, cool. Let us know that we've got something going on. Okay, so trees. Just hit play. See if that works. Okay, so it didn't go through anything. So let's find out what the deal is. So do they have a tile info? Let's just find out if anything's working. Okay, so it is iterating through all the rows and columns. eventually, you know, we could do this smarter where we actually wouldn't keep the player in the the map. Interesting. Now that I think about it, one of the ways that we're gonna, let's make this a little better actually. Let's go like this. Player start location. Because why iterate through all of them right here when we're gonna iterate through them when we create the map in the first place? Let's just do it there. And let's change this back to player location now that I've thought about it. Let's go start location. And it's gonna return player start location. Great. And then on this side, make that player start location. Okay, so the reason is we already know we're gonna iterate through when we create the map. Let's go do that with the player right here. So create a bulb forest tile. No, we're gonna load the map from data. This is where we wanna do it. So it's gonna place a tile. This is the tile info. Oh, it's not dot tile info. That's what was wrong with our other code, but that's okay. So let's go like this. If there's one I J. Dot type equals player, then okay, so what I'm going to do here is I'm going to make it so that when it's not the player, we print out the type, and that way if the type is wrong, like I would say, oh wait, yeah, we're in Lua. This is not, there we go, not equal. So when the type is not equal to player, we're gonna print its type. And then if I was wrong and the type of that tile is not player, we'll find out anyway. So let's go ahead and do that. Some trees, and we'll go down, throw a player on there, and then we will hit play. Okay, so that is not what we were hoping. that's because we want to print out the type. Throw some trees. Player. Play. Let's see what we got down here. Ooh, nil, 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 nil. They have no type. Nothing has a type. Alright, so we gotta figure out what our tile info is. And I remember this being a little silly. Builder settings, tile info, equals tile info, or dirt type. Dirt type is type 10, so it has a tile name, and the tile name is player. That's what we want. See, I don't remember everything. Most of the time, I don't. You just have to know how to navigate your code. Okay, trees. I want a player. Play. Hey, there's no player. And that's exactly what we want. We don't want to have the player on the map. It's great. They're all dirt. There's some trees thrown in there. Great. Okay, so what we do if they're not a player else. So when it is a player, what we're gonna do is go self dot player start location equals I J. Great. Now so that returns a start location, the location goes to set location, go to player. Now, what I'm thinking about is that the player is going to have to probably interact with the map. So the player is probably going to need a reference to the map so that it can do things like, given an I and a J, it's got to convert that to screen coordinates. So let's say we have these grids. I and J might be like, this is like 4 and whatever, like 6. That's 4 and 6, but we actually need to be able to draw the player, so we're actually going to need the pixel location here, which could be like, you know, 200, 400 or something. So let's go ahead and do that. I'll throw the player down here. Give it access to the map. Now we don't have a location on here, do we? We don't even have a visual item. So let's do that. So let's go like this. I call things view, like this is gonna be player view, to indicate where something is. Or I mean, to actually be the object, the visual object that is on the screen. And the reason I use view is because it's the part of it you view. And if you ever get into model view controllers, you can get into the details of like what the concept of a view is. But basically, it's the visual display versus like the data or the business logic. So the player is actually just going to be the exact same thing as a tile view, right? So we're going to start with this as the base of our player view. And yeah, we don't have a player create function, so let's go ahead and do that. Group to attach to, and Yeah, let's. So this is what the kind of stuff that we want to do. We want to go. Function. The fill color is just going to be our player fill color. Later we're going to replace this with the graphic, so I'm actually just going to copy it out of here. I don't need to actually link it to that value because it's not going to matter ultimately. 00, okay, so X and Y. Yeah, so let's go like this. Actually, let's do this. So player location equals map dot get. So when did we call that over here? Why were we calling it set location? Building the map name, blah blah blah. So, oh yeah, so we're just gonna get rid of this function for right now. Because we're going to move that into the player create. So what we're going to do is go self.playerCreate group. We're going to take both these and we are going to move them way down below the UI. Above the UI, because the UI needs a reference to the player. Let's see here. But we want to have the map loaded, all the data loaded, and then we can go ahead and take that data here. Okay, so we're gonna get the start location from the map and set it to player location. And then what we're gonna do is go map.get let's go display location from tile location. Actually, we're going to do this. Map location to display location. Self.player location dot I. Now you might be wondering why we don't just save the exact location in the map and like the actual visual location, so we don't have to do this conversion. The reason is that we're going to want to know the tile location. We're going to use the tile location for a variety of things, like figuring out where you're moving. So we don't just want its pixel value. We're gonna use both frequently. So it's kind of like the more standard one is gonna be the map location, the I and J tile location. And then, you know, we're gonna convert to the visual one mostly only when we are actually drawing it on the screen. So we need this function. Go check out our map. And give this function. Oh, interesting. We need a different one for I and J. So we're going to go XI, and we're going to make one, it's YJ. Now we could just do a conversion of both. Actually, you know what? Let's go back. Let's do a conversion of both. That's going to be better. Let's go local player display location. Off the I, because we're going to convert both the I and the J, and this can just be player display location dot x. Now what we could do is we could keep both the I and the J. So when we go through this map, we could do it here instead of just setting the I and the J. We could also set the X and the Y, but I want this conversion function because we're probably gonna use it a lot as a little helper to do things like this. So now this is kind of the concept of an interface, because this location object just needs to have a dot I and a dot J, but it could be anything. It could be a player, it could be a tile, it could be something else that we haven't created yet. So the concept is that the interface is has an I and a J, and then we can treat any object in here as having that, as long as it has that interface, is usable. Because we don't have actual type checking in Lua, that's not a worry, so we're not going to worry about that. Okay, we just have to do the conversion. I'm going to put these here as temporary placeholders. So to get that, what is it? It's times the tile size, which is saved in self.tileSize. Oh yeah, we could have used one function, but theoretically, you know, I don't want this to be too crazy if you were actually have a different tile height and width. So this allows for that. Okay. There we go. Okay. Times the tile size. Actually, is that it? Oh yeah, I guess we technically don't need to do anything else. Let's check how that works. Everything's broken. All right, what have we got? 49. Do these need to be something else, like equals? Why am I so bad at remembering that? Yes, they need to be equals. Save that. Do it. Yeah, I wasn't thinking about it, but this shouldn't be complicated. It would be a little more complicated if we didn't have our map at the origin. You'd have to add the offset, but that's not like a big deal. Oh yes, we wanted to do this. This is about as simple as it gets. Should move the player up in this list so I don't have to scroll to get to it. And I'm gonna do that. Next local map, a nil value. Okay, so why is that a nil value? Self.map. That's a map. It's a good question as to why that is. It's non-existent. Interesting. Attempt to index local map. Nil value. we're setting it to c.map. That doesn't look right. We shouldn't need to do that because this map should be this map. And this map should be, oh, no, there we go. That's a problem. Always save your files. Didn't save this forest file, so that's why that wasn't working. Okay. Oh, yeah, while I was doing this. The tiles come from builder settings. Let's take the player, move them all the way up. All right. So we just want to move this one down to 7. There we go. Way easier. Okay. Throw a player on there, some trees, hit play, find out what's broken. Old forest map, line 72. Self dot tile size, get tile size, tile size. I bet we're calling that wrong. Player. Yes, we are. Gonna play. Oh, dang. Now line 95. What we got there? Oh, that is not what we want to do. We're gonna return display location, which is going to be a new object. Because we don't want to alter the value that somebody has passed in. Player, play, got it, 96. Oh yeah, I didn't fix whatever the problem was there. Is it self.size? Did I do the same thing? This should probably be this with parentheses like that. And this should be with colon. There we go. Sorry, been working in Unity, which is fairly standard programming language. Okay, so our player moved, as you'll notice. It went from here to over there, which probably means we got our I and our J messed up. Interesting. So let's start here, make sure I is I, columns, J is rows, and this start location is exactly what we're going to pass to our function later here. Oh, ha. Huh. Might not be that, it might be this. How did I manage to do that? Probably the easiest way to not screw up would have been to make the X go to the X and the Y go to the Y. But cool, there we go. Put a player there. Hey, let's go to play. Nope. Where did our player go? That does not make sense. We're gonna. Ah. I think our player is just moving one. One tile over is the problem. We're seeing like the ghost of a player. Oh, you know what? We're seeing the ghost of players past. That's because we're not getting rid of our player. So let's make sure we do that. Player view. Then player view remove self. Okay. Yeah, it's just one down. So there we go. It's a little bit of messing around. Pretty sure this needs to be I minus one, J minus one. The reason for that being that one of these is one based and the other is zero based. So when you're actually at one, we want to subtract one so it becomes zero so that your actual location becomes zero. So if I put the player here, the player doesn't appear over here. Oh. Nope, that's not right. Let me see something. We're gonna find out where this guy is and why it's not where we think it is. Okay, so if I put the player here, its location is 1, 1, which should be exactly what we thought. You subtract one, that becomes zero. Multiply it by tile size, great. X and Y are zero. So why, pray tell, does the character fail to show? Let's try putting the player down here. Oh, what's going on? Getting half a player. Okay, something is not right there. Oh, yes. Multiplication happens before subtraction. That's why we need parentheses there. If you know your old mnemonic, it's presenting my dear Aunt Sally. So parentheses happen first, then multiplication, then division, and then addition and subtraction. The problem here was that before, without the parentheses, we were doing one times self size. And then we were subtracting that from I and J, which gets you a funky number, which is not at all what we wanted. But hey, there we go. Now we've got it. Now we're cooking with grease. We can put the player at any location, and the player is in that location as we expect. We screwed up something on the whole deleting, because we shouldn't see those ghosts hanging around. Maybe we are not. Ah, here we go. This is tile view. This, of course, needs to be player view. There we go. Now it's all good. Now if we put a player here, go to play, hey, go to build. The fact that we even see those is kind of a side effect of what we did, where we actually are deleting this when we move from screen to screen, which, you know, results in it not fading nicely from one to the other. We're going to fix that later, but the fact that we're not fading nicely is nice, because when we go to this black screen, we can see if we accidentally left any elements around, which is kind of good. Okay, so next up, we want to make that player move. So what I want to start with is we're just going to make the player move in a straight line. So if you click anywhere above the player or below the player or to the right or left in a straight line, the player will move to that location, straight up and down, etc. It's not going to move diagonally because to have it, let's say we have this thing going on, to have it actually go through here and figure out the location requires pathing, AI pathing, and we are not going to do that just yet. We're going to start with just super simple movement, and then I want to put enemies in that move, so that we have some kind of game situation going on. And then later we'll get into pathing. That may be what we do next week, because that could potentially take a long time. Okay. So, let's just make our player move. So, when we click our map, can get rid of this print. Any other garbage we're printing out? Has player table. Ah, that's not a spell table. I knew I should have just stopped after has player. It's only gonna be one location. There we go. Okay. Okay, so when you click, what have we got going on? We want the click to happen here. Oh, not there. Not in the builder. Let's close the builder for right now. Select tool. That's from the UI. What we want is selecting a location on the map. Yeah, so we touch, is new grid touch, dispatch. Select tile event, is a touch tile. There we go, select tile. Okay, here we go. This is what we want. So we'll remember we have all this set up from before. This allows us to touch tile, and then it calls this function. Now, what we want to do is, when we're given an X and a Y, what do we want to do with it? All right, let's do this. The event has an X and a Y, which are actually our I and our J. That's a little confusing. Probably shouldn't have done that, but I don't want to change it now because we're reusing this photo, this forest map elsewhere. So we're setting our target location. Okay. The player is going to take care of figuring out whether or not this is a valid target location, and then it's going to go there if it can. You might notice that, like, I try to keep my functions kind of organized in a certain way. Like, the top has the construction of the object, and then the create function, which I have as a separate thing. It could, all this stuff could be lumped into there, but I put it here because it's a little neater code. I wouldn't be referencing everything as C dot instead of using self like I do everywhere else. Then I have these functions, which are our deduct and add item for when we harvest stuff. And then I have like these event listeners, and then I have the remove. And so like most of my other functions are going to go in between here. So it's kind of like creation, all kinds of like normal functions that make it work. Event listeners and other like generic helper functions, and then the destruction of the object. It's helpful to keep everything organized in some fashion, because it will make it much easier when you're looking for stuff later. Although, if you're using Sublime, a nice thing is Command-R, and you can just see all the method names. It makes it super easy to jump right to whatever you want to do. Okay, so this is actually an I and a J. So, okay, if that's really annoying. I should definitely change that at some point soon. Okay, so this is what I was talking about. We are going to make sure that either it's X or it's Y, it's on the same plane. Otherwise, we're not going to do anything with it. And here's where I convert it back to I and J. Okay, so one or the other is in line with it. We're going to set its target location to that. Now, that doesn't mean anything. The target location doesn't do anything. But let's go ahead. No, we're going to go for it. We'll test it all out in a moment. So at the beginning, its target location is its current location. It's not going to move. That makes perfect sense. So we need an update function. This is for the player is moving. So we're going to go ahead and do this. We may want to swap these, map update and player update. I don't know yet. We're going to save that for the future, figure out whether or not we need to do that. For right now, we're not. Okay. So what I'm doing here is I'm going to do a very simple movement that just updates its current location to we're gonna do this. I'm gonna make a function. Okay, let's do this. We need a new object. If I just did self.playerLocation, we'd have a problem because it would actually alter self.playerLocation because it would be a reference. So we need to create a new one. Ba-ba-ba-ba-ba. Okay, so that's a new location. Now we're gonna do like this. So if that's less, then we're gonna go new location dot I equals player location plus one. I'm actually gonna do this because this is the player location. I'm just gonna use new location. It's actually gonna be just because it's less code. It's kind of simple. Cool. And since it can't be doing all these things at once, I'm going to make the other three. There we go. So this one's, if it's greater, this one is the J, and this one. As if the J is great, or whoops, yeah, there we go, greater. Okay, now we're gonna copy these. All right, if it's greater, then we're gonna subtract one. Now we're gonna do the J's. If the J is less, we're gonna go ahead and add one, and then we're gonna do the J's here. And subtract one. Pretty simple. Now, okay, so what we want to do is set the player's view to the new location. And this is where that function is going to come in handy, where we go self.map.mapLocation to display location. Nope, we're going to do the opposite one. We're going to do get display location to map location. Probably should not be get. That doesn't actually make any sense, but should be like convert. I'm gonna go ahead and fix that because that's gonna annoy me now that I'm thinking about it. Okay, so we're gonna call this convert. We're gonna find the other one, get map. Okay, fortunately that's the only place that it's being used. I'm gonna say convert. We're gonna copy our new function title, go over here, change this to convert. We are going to duplicate this function, change its name. Okay, and actually, you know what? Let's make this like our notes to ourselves. And in this one, our location object must have X and Y. So what we want to do is now we're going to return I and a J. Based on an X and a Y, which we're actually going to reverse this. So first we're going to divide by that. And in this case, because it's division, we're going to need math.floor. And then we should want to subtract one. I also think, okay, so that's what we want for the other, got our two conversion methods, great. Let's make sure that we weren't using it here, good. Just want to make sure that name change is for all the instances. But I actually just realized we're not going to want to convert display location. No, we are doing a convert map location to display location. So we just added a helper for no reason, but I'm sure we'll use it in the future. No worries. Also, I should be doing this. This is the... Oop. Because remember, this function does both locations at once. So new location, I'm just going to convert. And then we are going to change this to just nice new location dot x and new location dot y. All right, let's see if any of this worked. Okay, so... play. Failure. Line 32. Yep. It's be an equal sign. I'll never get that right. Alright, hit play. What else do we have? Bolt player 50. Player target location. Yep, did it again. Okay, drop a player. Okay, we're here. And nothing's happening. Okay, cool. Well, we are somewhere. So let's start by going to this, saying print. self dot player target location. So let's just find out where the player is trying to go at all times. Oh, yep. We want to see actually the individual I and J. And 9. I'm going to guess that's right. And now we want it to go to 1 and 1. If I click here, nothing's happening. So that's our first clue. I'm going to comment this out for a moment. And touching does nothing. Okay, good to know. I'm a listener, select tile. Let me see something. Builder. Oh, it's UI select tile. That's not what we want. What we want is place tile. There isn't a place tile, is there? Yeah, that is not an event that we're listening on. Does seem to be getting, that's because it's a bold builder map, not a forest map. Let's go look at our game and see if we are, see we are using select tile here for planting and blah blah blah. But see, I think at some point we might have broken that. See, so let's go see if I go home. Ooh. Bulb player. Oh, that's because we have the player. We're reusing the player in other locations. So, first let's go bulb home, which also has the player. There is no map in here. So we actually need two different types of player. So let's go ahead and one, we're going to go into the bulb game. We're going to give this player the map because it's going to need the map. Okay, that's great. But here in the home, it's not going to need the map and there's not going to be a map. So let's make it. In that case, we're probably not going to call player update. That's not a thing that we're going to need to do in the home. But we are going to do this. So what we're going to do is go if map. We're only going to set that stuff if there's a map. And we're going to do the same down here. Actually, kind of think we need a different type of player for the home and the map, but for right now, I think these little fixes will suffice. So we can go to the home. Hey, we can talk to them. We can click these, which do nothing. We can go to the garden. Get tile size, line 14. Interesting. how is map something? When you go to bulb game. Oh yeah, it is getting the map. This map is a bulb map, it's not the forest map. Ah, it's not the forest map. Interesting. This is where it might have been good to, again, make them one thing or build them off of each other. Use some form of inheritance or construction to make them the same thing. Oops, I just knocked out my second screen. But we're not going to do that for right now. We're just going to copy these functions over. I know it's not ideal, but ain't nobody got time for something more than that. Okay, so this is also going to need other functions. The player is going to need, let's see, oh, that's not where I want to do it. We're going to go here, go map, gotta get the tile size, get the player start location. Need the convert map. Okay, that's all it's gonna need. Okay, cool. So let's get those conversions. Drop those over here. Now we're of course going to have to change all these from forest map to bulb map. Great. Let's go see if that works. Hey, we're at the garden. We can place some blueberries. We can place some avocados. We can shovel them. That's great. So now what I want to know is why. Actually, I'm not sure. So we go home, we can go to the forest. The forest is broken from there. That's actually expected. I'm not going to worry about that. So we put a player. That's what I want to know. I want to know why the tools work off of this map and not off the other map. So here we go. Select tile. See? Select tile event. Select tile. We go into our forest. Why did I call it touch tile? I have no idea why I changed it to touch tile. That seems really weird. Is the bulb builder using touch tile? No, it uses select tile. Oh, that's right. Because I have select tile in the UI, so I wanted something different. But what's interesting is this is place tile. It doesn't say touch tile, it says place tile. It says place tile because it is using a different map. It's using the builder map. If we open the builder map, we have too many maps. The builder map uses place tile. Which is so silly that I have three different ways of doing that. So one, I'm gonna leave this as touch tile. We're going to go into this forest and we're going to make our event touch tile. And later, we should probably consolidate those to use one event that is the same on all three, because otherwise, it's totally ridiculous. Okay. Let's see if that works. Nothing? No? Oh, yes. That's because this touch tile needs to be the same method name as that. Hey, there we go. Something's happening. All right, so if I click here, it does nothing. But if I click here, yeah, I think I'm not updating something. Let's get rid of all this other garbage. Now that we know what's going on, we can fix all this stuff. Okay, so player. This is one annoying thing, because right now this just updates the view, but then we actually need to update the player's location. This is one of the things I don't like, and we might want to change at some point. The view location is not that's what we're gonna do. I'm gonna make it like this. We're going to make a new function called update view location. An update view location is going to, oh yeah, it's not gonna do anything there. What it's gonna do is it's gonna take self.playerLocation. It's gonna convert it into a new location, and then it's gonna set it. This way, we don't mess around with the view location directly. We change the tile location, and then we let this update view location function actually update it. That'll work for now. We're probably gonna have to change it to make it like animate, make it smooth. Yeah, see, well, actually, it's not bad right now. I mean, it's super fast. See, look, so you can click around, it doesn't work, but if you click anywhere vertically or horizontally in line, it will move at one tile and update and get to that location. So that's cool. We've got a player now moving to a given location. But now what we want to do is we want to go back and we want to put trees in the way. And then when you go to play, you want to run into those trees. And right now, that's not happening. Also, I'm going to do a little hack to make this a little easier, so I don't have to keep doing this. We're gonna do this. We're gonna save this as init, like our initial map. We are gonna go to Bulb Builder, and as soon as we're done creating it, we are going to load that file. So create a load file, give it a file name, loading, blah blah, load map from data. This is what we want, this function. We're gonna go here. We're gonna have it load this init map. We're not gonna care about failures because we're gonna assume that it works. And if it doesn't, we'll come investigate. File name is gonna be init. Might need to be init.txt. I don't know if we added. Nope, there we go. See, there it is. So now I don't have to go and make it every time that we're gonna go and test this, which would be super annoying. And if we wanna change it, we can just go ahead and throw something in there. Then we'll just go save, go init. Save over it. Now if we refresh, hey, it loaded it. So that's great. So in our forest, okay, now we're gonna go take a look at our player. Da, 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 da. So one of the things I like to do is that, what we could do here is we could say like, hey, if that new location is a tree, don't let the player go there. If we said, is that a quote unquote blocking element, don't let the player go there. So then we flag them as blocking elements. But then if we just give it a general type, like, so like basically we want to say self.map. Basically we want to say open to player. Because we might make a series of different types of objects that block the player in different ways, and they have other different attributes based on that. So we're going to start with that as a simple method. And of course, it's going to be the same as this. And we have to do that for each of these things, so bring it down here. I'm just duplicating these and moving them down. Saves me a little typing. Okay, so there we go. And that one's that. This one is this. This one is that. And this one is that. Great. Okay, cool. So, now we need that open to player function. And we could move this onto the player itself. Like maybe the player just says like, hey, what is this item? Oh, if it's X type of item, I'm not gonna move there. That's stuff that we could easily change later and swap it from one place to the other. It depends on whether or not it depends on where we want it to be, and there's different reasons for that. We're not going to worry about that just yet. Actually, so what we're going to do is, that's the new I location. So what we're going to do is go new location dot J. Let's do this. I'm going to get rid of all of these. I just had a thought. Maybe this is a better way to do it for right now. Eventually we're going to change this to some kind of pathing. So I want kind of path of least resistance right now to make some just basic movement. So we're just going to say, because we actually need to know if the entire location is not just, we're not just doing the X or the Y. So it's going to be easier if we go like this. If the new location, now that we've altered it, and this is the actual new location, if it's open to the player, then set it. Great. Do is go layers one location dot I location dot j. Okay, so we're going to do this goal tile dot walkable. Then actually, we're just going to return goal dot walkable. This will evaluate if we set walkable to true. This will evaluate to true. If we set it to false, it will. Or if we don't set it, then it'll evaluate as false. So we don't have to actually set it. So we're going to go bulb. I guess we're going to use builder settings. It's interesting that we're using quote unquote builder tiles in our maps. Probably shouldn't have named this builder settings. It's actually, you know, these tile types should go somewhere that is bulb forest types or forest settings or something. But we're not going to worry about that. What we're going to do is we want enemy 2. These, so enemy, like enemy 1 and enemy 2 don't need walkable or not walkable, and neither does player, because those things are actually going to be replaced by dirt. So dirt is walkable for sure. Lava, we're going to make it walkable, but it's going to hurt you. So that's going to be true. Walls are not walkable. Seeds, again, that's going to be replaced by dirt eventually. And the river is not walkable. So we're going to go ahead and do that. That should be good. Okay, so let's make several of these different things so that we can see this working. And I think we're good. Oh yeah, we have enemy types, but those are gonna get changed later. Kind of gives us a little bit of everything. Go ahead and save this as a init. There you go. Oops. Just replace that. That's okay. Actually, let's just go to play. Should have replaced that with whatever. Nope. That's right. It's using temporary. Let's just go load. Init. There we go. Okay, cool. So that's that. Do we actually have this running? Okay. We're gonna print its name just to see if this is even happening. Fascinating. Why can I go? Oh, now I'm just jumping all over the place. That's not what we want at all. How do we screw that up? What was it before? So it was just player location equals new location. New location is just, you know, we've altered the I and the J by one. So why, when I do this, if open a player, new location player, should still just be moving him by one. I don't. Oh! I'm sitting here thinking, like, why is this player jumping around? That's because we're not in the play mode. We are in the build mode. Okay, so I want to go to this tile. Gold tile is nil. Why is gold tile nil? Go look at our map. Does not have a tile name. Let's make sure that this has an I and a J. Is coming through there as 11 and 9, but it's not getting a tile name. So why on the map are we not getting 11 and 9? Should be a tile. Oh, it's a tile. Now these are tiles. So the tiles are actually going to have a tile info. So this should be tile info. That still should have been a table, though. Oh, no, there it is. Its target is dirt. Why is it not moving? That's because we need to look at. No, that's tile info. So let's say walkable. Says walkable true. Oh, interesting. As soon as I clicked one of these, walkable is not true. Let's take a look at these. So these are creating bulb forest tiles. Tile info is the tile info, or the bulb settings dirt type. If we're looking at that bulb settings dirt type, that is just one of these types. Should be tile info. Interesting. Very interesting. This is the tile info. We were able to get the tile's name. Walkable. Did we not spell it right? No. That looks right. Interesting. Not entirely sure why this is not working. Gold tile walkable. Did I screw it up somehow? Ah, I know what it is. These are not, these don't have the walkable value. Because they did not exist before I added the walkable value. So let's say clear, put in a player, put in some trees, hit play. Ah, here we go. There it is. Our init map no longer works because our init map is screwed up. Because our init map is old data. This is something you'll learn every time you update stuff. You have to go update old data. Now that we're saving our maps, you're gonna wanna do that. However, I'm not gonna make an update function right now. That's something to put on a to-do list. And actually, you know what? We're gonna go ahead and add a new file. We're gonna save it. And we're gonna save this as our to-do list. This is gonna be something to keep track of some of those things that we wanna do that we have not done yet. Okay, so we're gonna make a migration function for maps eventually. What that'll do is that if you change tile information, we'll have a function that we can just run on all of our maps to go and say, all right, take all those maps and update all of their tiles and everything to be the right thing. And actually, another way to do it would be if you look at our maps, which, let's see if I have that directory still. Oops. open anymore. But anyway, if you were to look at our maps, like, they're saving the entire tiles information. They don't actually need to do that. What they really need to save is just what type of tile they are. Because if you just said, like, oh, this is a dirt tile, well, when we load the map, we can say, okay, dirt tile is this key, so replace that tile with this object. So, that being the case, that might be better because then our maps are simpler when they're saved, but it means it takes a little more work to generate them. But I really don't think it's that much work, so that's probably what we're going to eventually want to do. So anyway, simpler save. And if we remember anything else we want to do, let's add it to this to-do list. But for now, let's go ahead and clear, add a player, put some trees, put another set of trees. Here's an enemy. Here's a river. Some seeds by the river. Here's a bunch of lava. And a little wall. There we go. Okay, so now we're going to go ahead and save that over our init function. Then we're going to play. Now, as you can see, okay, so we run into the walls. That's what we wanted. Okay, so we're going to go here, here. Hey, we can move through there, but we can't move through that. Can't move through the water. That's great. That's what we wanted. Cool. So we've got a player that can move around. Great. Oh, can't walk through seeds. Well, I guess can't walk through seeds or enemies yet because we're not replacing them. They're not existing on top of the map. Okay, so we have some basic walking. Like I said, I don't want to do our pathing algorithm just yet, because that'll actually take a lot of time. So instead, what I'm going to do is we're going to go ahead and add enemies and seeds. Or at least enemies, and then we'll look at seeds later. Okay, so let me go ahead and make a new file. Call this a bulb enemy. Oop, why am I finding? Should be saving. Okay. It's going to pull the enemy and paste this guy. Let's see what we've got. So we'll leave our generic event functions in case we need them. We are going to replace player view, enemy view. Great, it's gonna need a map. Does not need this item bag. In the event, it's gonna need the, we got the map. Let's go ahead and replace this other stuff as well while we're at it. Player size with enemy size. Again, we can make this more generic and use it in both places. That would be probably smart, but this is gonna change a lot. So I'm gonna wait a little bit until we actually have some good idea of how similar these are. Then I'll show you how to go and fix it, which is not the right way to do it. But it is the faster way. And what we care about is making the game. We're not entirely concerned with making it super, super polished code. Actually, you know, what I should do is this. Find out what it is. There we go. We're going to do this. We're going to go enemy size, and we're going to replace that with just size. then we're gonna take enemy location. We're gonna change that to just location. We're gonna take its target location. Now this might break something if we're passing in location somewhere, and it conflicts with the self location, but I don't think we're doing that anywhere, so we're not gonna worry about it just yet. Okay, there we go. Okay, so we're gonna create it, do the same kind of conversion, blah blah blah. Let's go get the enemy. You know what? I go like this. Huh, how do we do that? This is what we want. Da-da-da-da-da. I'm gonna assume that it has to have a tile info. And actually, I'm gonna place it here. Show you why in a second, because we're gonna have multiple enemies and we want to be able to tell which kind of enemy we're looking at. Okay, it goes and displays it, great. Gonna leave its movement the same. That's great. Set target location. We're going to leave that. And we are going to not have a deduct item. Item and event listener. Remove. Blah, blah, blah. Great. So let's also do this and go player. Just want to see. It's just in those names. Yeah, the location. Interesting. Why did I do that? Oh, because a player is going to have one single start location. Well, we'll see. I have a different idea of how we're going to do the enemies, but we'll get to that in a second. Anyway, I'm going to take bulb player and call it bulb enemy. Place all those. That's great. Okay. So I'm just trying to think if we want the enemies to live on the map or to just live here on our forest, which is actually where we probably want them to live right now. Things are a little interesting. So it's always a predicament to figure out where your data should live. So for instance, what I'm thinking is if the views of the enemies and the player lived in the map, it would mean that they could just live on a different layer as the background, and the map could control the visuals of moving them around and everything, which would be good in a way. And in some ways it wouldn't be good. So right now I'm trying to think if we're going to spawn enemies, we need to spawn them and their data somewhere. It needs to live somewhere. Right now it would live in this bulb forest class. Why don't we just go ahead and do that? We'll pursue that for right now. We might find that that's a bad idea and have to go back and fix it. But for now, we're just going to roll with it. you could spend a lot of time thinking about how something should be structured, and odds are you're just going to be like wasting a lot of time that you could have spent actually just building it. And yeah, figuring it out. Just build it, figure it out, figure out what you did wrong, fix it. That's a good way to go about things. I can't remember what these dumb for loops look like. There we go. I wonder if it should be local. Just gonna get us the data for where we have enemies, right? And then we're gonna create one. Just gonna be a bulb enemy. Get access to the map. Great. Oh yeah, I wanna import this. We have bulb enemy. It's great. Map, get enemies. Just realizing that I should have done this a little slightly different. We're gonna move this up here, we're gonna move this down here. We're gonna make this if it equals players. Because then we're gonna make this one. Ooh, interesting. You know what? We're gonna go like this. Is enemy. We actually don't need that, we just do this. There we go. And that's not what we want at all, actually. What we want to do is go... enemies. We're just going to add an element to this array. And it's going to be the entire info. Great. Our build settings, we're going to have to make this is enemies, which is means that we are going to have to remake our map again. That's annoying. Might write that conversion function sooner rather than later. Okay, is enemy, blah, blah, blah. Okay, so if it's an enemy, we're gonna add it to the enemies, that's great. Otherwise, we're gonna place a tile. Enemies, blah, blah, blah. We're gonna create an enemy. We'll make sure we have that. Map, tile info. So what I want to do is go like this. Map, enemies, I. That's great. And instead of doing get player start location, we're going to just do this. Oh, dang it. We're going to need something a little more. We're going to go in here and we're going to go I is I. Oop, got to use equals. J equals J. Tile info equals that tile info. Okay, so there's our enemy and all its data. And over here on this side, we're going to have to do this, get its tile info. And then we're going to also, actually, you know what? We're just going to pass the whole thing in. That's fine. We're going to go into here. We're going to go enemy info. We're going to do enemy info dot tile info. That goes there. And then location, I equals enemy info dot I. And J equals enemy info dot J. Okay. Okay, that's largely it. Now, actually, let's just override our enemies. And save this as init. And now let's go play. And see what we broke. Line 50. What was its problem? Attempt to perform arithmetic. Yes, I did. I should be using a hash sign to get its length. All right, 47. Not immediately obvious. Oh, 4 is, it's over here. 47. Self, get enemies. Save it to enemies. We probably don't have a get enemies function. Now, I could just use enemies, but sometimes I like to make a getter and setter function because that is nicer. It's what you should be doing. It's what you actually need in other languages to have actual information hiding. But not now. Okay, so 20, tile view. Why do we not have tile view? Nil value. What? That should be an enemy view. There we go. To copied and pasted that from somewhere. Okay, cool. So now, cool thing is we should be able to walk right through the enemies. They're there, but they're above the player. Okay, so now we've got an enemy. We've got a couple of enemies, actually. Now we need to make them move. Now what we're going to use is called a strategy pattern. And the idea is that we are going to do this. We're going to go we're gonna call this AI strategy. And we're gonna go bulb. We get settings. Do we ever use this anywhere? No. Just in the forest tile. I'm trying to remember. Bulb builder settings. There we go. Okay, so what we're going to do with this, we are going to go get strategy for enemy. Then we're going to do enemy we're actually going to do tile info. So tile info dot name. And in here in our build settings. Bold build settings. I copy and paste. Write this wrong. It's always good to copy and paste so you don't accidentally screw something up. We're gonna type and now we are going to say if type equals enemy one, then do this stuff. Else if type equals enemy two, do that stuff. What is that stuff? Well, that stuff is simple. It's going to be return enemy. We're gonna call this AI strategy one. We're gonna call this one AI strategy two. Well, what are those? Those are two new things that we're gonna add. Old AI strategy one and bulb AI strategy two. And those don't exist, which is why that's freaking out. That's fine. File, save it, bulb AI strategy one, and we'll make a new file. Oops, gotta add the file extension. We're gonna save this one, bulb AI strategy two. Great. Now we have those guys. Now we're just gonna copy this as a basis. And we're gonna get rid of all this garbage because none of this is applicable. Save it. I'm gonna close it because it's currently looking at it as if it's a text file. It's not. Right, bulb AI strategy one. This and paste it here, make this one a two, there we go. Okay, so what happens? Why do we have the strategy? So what happens is we're gonna get a strategy based on the name of the enemy. This strategy is what we're gonna consult to figure out things like, hey, where does this enemy wanna go? So what we're gonna do is go this could get more complicated later, but for right now we're just gonna go like this. We're gonna go self.ai strategy dot get next location self. So what's happening here is we're gonna say, hey, AI strategy, here, I'm gonna give you my information, so that's self. Tell me my next location, tell me where I wanna go. And the AI strategy is gonna go figure that out for you. And then it's gonna give it a target location. Then based on our normal code, we're gonna go figure out what that should be. And then we're gonna execute on it. So, that is the basis of it. Super simple. So now all we need is this get location. We're gonna move this over here so we can see them side by side. And we're gonna call this, actually, you know what? So we're gonna do this, let's leave it as map and enemy info. That's perfect. That's actually what we want. We're gonna leave out events for right now. We don't need any of this tile info, and we don't need any view. This set doesn't have any view. We're gonna call this enemy. Well, we're just gonna call it enemy. To remind us that it's actually an enemy object and not just nothing. Not like just enemy info that we use elsewhere. Okay, so here we go. Strategy. Bam. Get next location. What get next location is going to do is something. Why does it still not look right? View, syntax, Lua. It usually means I did something wrong, screwed something up. That is why things are not, like, this should be green. Like it is over here when I have a function. Usually means I screwed something up, but I can't tell what I screwed up that's causing it to fail. Ah, it's the one. It doesn't think numbers should be in the names of functions or classes or whatever. Well, that's really annoying, but we're gonna ignore it for right now. It's not important. Okay, so how are we gonna figure out what to do with this guy? So this one, we're gonna do a description of this. We're gonna say AI strategy one, bounce player back and forth horizontally. Okay, so what we're gonna do is we're gonna get our next location. So we're gonna go enemy, and it should have a location, is part of the reason why I took off enemy location. Okay, so enemy location, and we are going to add one to its eye. What we're actually gonna do is basically this chunk here. That in. Okay, so we're going to go going left. All right. Do some stuff. So if self dot going left, then all right, now actually I don't know if this is what we want here. We're just gonna do this. Okay, so let's try this. So we've got its location, that's our new location. If, oh yep, we're going to new location dot I minus one, because we're going left. And then we're going to say if enemies are going to have the same open as open to player for right now. Probably going to change that to open to enemy. If we want to make them be able to walk places that the player can't, we'll take a look at that later. I'm not going to worry about it just yet. And if it's open to the enemy, then we are going to return new location. And then it's actually going to go through in here and do all that test again. But that's okay, because we might have strategies that, like in the future, that give it illegal places to go. For instance, in like, let's say an enemy that always goes just straight, and then this would actually stop it from going somewhere that it can't go. But yeah, I don't know. Now that I think about that, strategy is probably going to cover this, whether or not it can actually move there or not. But for now, I'm going to leave it. It's not going to break anything. So if it's open to player, then it's going to go there. Otherwise, we're going to set going left to false and return enemy.location. So it's not going to move anywhere. And then we're gonna do this. If it's not, oh, actually, here, we're gonna do this. This is gonna make it nice and simple. If we're not going left, that means we're going right. We're gonna add one. And it's the same logic here. If it's open to the player, then we're gonna go there. And we're gonna return that as a new location, set it as its new target location. Otherwise, we're gonna set it to going the other way. So let's go ahead and save that. And we have an error loading it because something's wrong. Please tell me what's wrong. Line 15, something. Oh yes, this is not proper Lua code. Not actually proper any code. Okay, now, since I'm reasonably confident in this and I don't want to have things broken, I'm gonna go and make a player 2 version, or I mean AI strategy 2. Go here, 2, 2, 2. And this, we're going to just change these I's to J's. And we're going to make this vertically. Oh yes, and going left is going up. Okay, great. Done that. We've set them here. They need a map and an enemy. Map and enemy. What we're actually gonna do is go here, connect location. This is what we're gonna do. We're going to make a create function. This is one of the reasons why I have a create function, usually. Because I'm often doing something like this. Gonna get rid of that. These nil for starters. When we call create, we're gonna do self.map equals map. Enemy. Bam. Save that guy. Copy this. Go over to 2. Paste it over it. Change its name to 2. Save it. That's all well and good. So now we don't have any methods there. We build an enemy. Let's see, AI strategy, get strategy for enemy, blah, blah, blah. Then we're gonna do this. AI strategy, create with map and self. There we go. All right, looking pretty good. Let's see if that works. I have to end this very quickly, so I certainly hope it works. It does not. Nothing happens. I know why nothing happens, because we're not updating our enemies. I am going to cut this off before the 2-hour mark, which I'm going to continue to do from now on, because if I go over 2 hours, YouTube can't take it, and it'll be this dumb, like, 5-minute video. So if this doesn't work, I might cut off a little early, and we will explore this next time. 2 hours is a long time to hear somebody speak. So here we go. This is a new enemy. Oh yes, so we gotta go self dot enemies is hashtag self dot enemies plus 1 equals a new enemy. So that sets it to this list. That's great. Now an update. We're gonna go do this. It's gonna be self dot enemies. And then it's just self.enemies update. update method is a nil value. No. What? How is update method a nil value? Oh, yes. I. Okay, play. AI strategy 1, line 18. I'm trying to move very quickly. New location is enemy dot location. Enemy does not have a location? No. Okay, location. Oh, that's if we give it a map. Do we give it a map? We give it a map. And let's go look at this. Line 18. New location is enemy dot location. Enemy is a nil value. That's right, because this should be self.enemy. And that means this one down here needs to be self.enemy. That's great. Okay. What else we got? Oh, come on, guy. Oh, wait. Was that AI strategy 2? No. Enemy has a map. So it's just enemy is a nil value. Oh, you know what? I know why it is. Because this needs to be C. You can't use self in the creation method. Alright. Global enemy. Yes. AI strategy 2. Alright, quick countdown. 2 minutes. Remember... like, subscribe, do all that business. Please watch these, share them with your friends, etc. Don't hate me if I don't get this done and we have to continue it next time. It's not my problem, it's YouTube's annoying problem. Okay. Location IJ. This goal tile is not getting a location IJ. Okay, I'm going to cut it off because I only have a minute left. We will look into this later. I'm going to clean up the code in a way that can be grabbed off of GitHub. It's almost all there. If it's something super minor, I might just fix it and make a note to talk about it next time. But yeah, go check it out. Like, subscribe, follow me on Twitter, all of that stuff. Have a good one, and